Now, this model, it's still CLT. The model is we have incoming information here, and our first block of memory is the sensory memory, highly volatile. It's kind of like RAM in a computer. It kind of goes away like very quickly. And if something comes into your sensory memory here, if you don't have the capacity or the motivation to hold it, it is quickly forgotten, right? Unless you transfer that to your working memory. Your working memory is right here, and you have a chance to rehearse it a bit. If you have a chance to play around with that shiny new object, almost like a musician as well. When you go over a chart, when you sight read for the first time, it's probably pretty good, but it could be better with rehearsal. Even myself, I as a musician, I need to go over a chart in my head or on a practice pad or something like that, at least 3 to 5 times before I feel somewhat competent that I can execute, right? I know some sick musicians who they could just, you know, look at it once and say, yeah, I got it. Right? I'm not there, you know, and we're all at different places, right? This also suggests...
The Army likes to call that see one, do one, teach one.
Oh my gosh, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. Yeah, and cool. We even talked about that recently as well. If you don't do what Tiger mentioned, that is quickly forgotten. I was like, oh yeah, I guess so. If you don't rehearse, you don't teach somebody else that, chances are it's pretty quickly forgotten. Now, the whole goal is to take that experience and encode it into LTM with the hope that you're going to be retrieving that a lot to help solve any problem that you may be working with at the problem at hand, right? And here's one other thing as well. If this retrieval of that particular index, if it doesn't happen like a lot, it's also quickly forgotten. You know, that was something that we were looking at, and we're like, oh yeah, if you don't retrieve something for a long time, it kind of gets lost. I mean, it may still be there, but it may take a little bit longer to retrieve. Now, here's something else. Research does suggest that interesting, engaging, and low-effort activities support the higher learning without introducing more cognitive load, right? That was interesting because some of those low-effort activities, you can't live off the low-effort activities, and you can't have just that high-effort activities, right? So it's a combination of both. And some of those examples could be using CodeShare to share out some code in real time and where we all do a bug scrub and we all do the bug hunt. And we take down the big boss together as a team, right? That's one thing that has been a no load activity. Right, that kind of helps support the bigger learning. And the other one, there is actual recent research on Kahoot. And that's where we take the quizzes and drop them into like a game show format, like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? And I think it's pretty interesting in the fact that it will support the, you can't live off of it, but it'll help support that bigger learning portion. And it gets us through doing a quiz. I mean, because there's taking a multiple choice quiz, looking at a screen when you're by yourself. Yeah, I don't know about you folks, but it's not that much fun for me. Yeah. I mean, maybe it's fun for you, but Research does suggest too that if you're using a platform like Kahoot and you're having fun answering questions like who wants to be a millionaire in that kind of format, first of all, that could probably be a substitute for quizzes because there are bigger things we have to work on. Kind of breaks up the monotony of things, right? And it's no load. It's no additional load. I like it for students. Not sure I like it so much for the instructors because they put the instructors behind a paywall. Having a wider variety of rigorous, relevant, and accessible activities, we hope to ensure equity in education for diverse communities. I hope you enjoyed it. I had a good time putting this together for you as well.